Coming up, what does a recent court decision really mean for CFIs? We get the legal answer.
Plus, 124 lives changed with flight training scholarships and honoring a life well lived. AOPA Live this week begins in just a moment.
This is AOPA Live this week with Tom Haynes and Alyssa Cobb.
Well, despite reports to the contrary, the sky is not falling.
That's right. Social media and some media have been all a Twitter about how a recent court decision will mean the death of flight instruction. Not true.
The only thing we know coming out of this court decision is that to provide flight instruction in a limited category aircraft, you need to have an exemption in place. That's the only thing that is clear from the Warbird Adventures decision.
So no, flight instructors do not need a second class medical. Flight schools do not need a Part 135 certificate. But AOPA and other organizations are pushing the FAA to clear up ambiguities that might come from this court decision.
The FAA has always consistently said that when you get paid to provide student instruction, you're getting paid for the instruction. You are not getting paid to transport the student from A to B. And there are federal register notices that say this, and there are multiple legal interpretations. So this language is at odds in the court decision with the FAA's longstanding policy position on this, and that's why we need to see what the FAA's interpretation is on how this could impact the FAA's view and perspective.
So certainly a lot of confusion yet, Alyssa, and some interpretation due from the FAA. So let's see what they have to say, and hopefully it clears things up and makes it a lot simpler for flight instructors and flight schools.
That's right. Much needed guidance.
Absolutely.
Well, a temporary sigh of relief for the pilots at Dillingham Airfield in Hawaii. The state extended the eviction date by 6 months, so tenants on the airfield who were going to be evicted on June 30th now have a deadline of December 31st. The state wants to close the field to public access due to funding issues. The field is leased by the state from the Army. Now, AOPA has been working hard with many stakeholders to save the airport. It's home to 11 businesses that employ over 130 people. It's especially popular for skydivers, too. Tens of thousands of visitors come to skydive at Dillingham each year, and it's a major economic driver for the area. AOPA appreciates the work officials and other stakeholders are doing to find solutions to several complex issues at the airfield. But we're disappointed that there's still another arbitrary eviction date on the table. We're continuing our fight for the airport and we'll keep you updated on the progress. Well, lives transformed and dreams fulfilled. That's what our flight training scholarships are all about. The goal is to give funds to boost aviation careers, and this year we're awarding more than $1.1 million in scholarships to 124 recipients. They include high school students and teachers, aspiring pilots, pilots in training, and pilots pursuing advanced ratings. We caught up with high school flight training scholarship winner Sydney Whistler and asked how she felt when she found out that she won a $10,000 flight training scholarship.
I couldn't even believe it. I don't think it fully registered until like the day after. I was like, oh my gosh, I won it. And I called everyone I knew interested in aviation field and whoever pushed me. I was like, oh, I got it. And they were all so excited. So I couldn't be happier.
Sydney flies gliders now, and she hopes to use the scholarship money to get a jump start toward her dream career as a commercial airline pilot. She's extremely grateful to the donors who funded her scholarship.
Just thank you so much for being able to make my dreams come true and flying. And like I said, I can't thank you enough. It means so much to me.
The Ray Foundation, established by late aviator, philanthropist, and entrepreneur James C. Ray, donated $1 million for the high school student and teacher scholarships. Other generous donations to the AOPA Foundation also help fund the scholarships and support the future of general aviation. Well, congratulations to the 2021 scholarship winners.
Absolutely. Way to go. How can we get to yes? Not something you're used to hearing from the FAA's medical folks, but hey, there's a new sheriff, a new federal air surgeon in town, and she seems committed to making the medical process faster and more transparent. In the latest issue of FAA Safety Briefing, Federal Air Surgeon Dr. Susan Northrup writes that her goal is to issue an aeromedical decision within 60 days. And for people who don't meet standards for medical certification, see if there's a way to still safely certify the pilot or air traffic controller. She concludes writing, "We remain committed to the pathway to yes." She also commits to that in her guest editorial in the June issue of AOPA Pilot Magazine. And now some changes at the National Transportation Safety Board. The Associated Press reports this week that NTSB Chairman Robert Sumwalt will step down at the end of June. Sumwalt is a former airline pilot and executive and AOPA member. He's been on the board since 2017. Board member Jennifer Hamadeh will likely be nominated to be the new NTSB chairman.
An amazing milestone for an experienced pilot. Veteran ferry pilot Margaret Waltz just landed her 900th ferry flight. And she's a pro at bringing airplanes across the North Atlantic. Waltz completed trip number 900 in a TBM 940. She picked it up at the factory in France and 3 days later arrived in Muncie, Indiana, where this photo was taken. She's delivered more than 200 TBMs since 1991, taking them to North America, Africa, Asia, and even Australia. The German-born pilot lives in Pennsylvania but spends countless hours in the air. Well, congratulations, Margaret. What an accomplishment.
Yes, congrats, Margaret. Virtual and augmented reality have come a long way in recent years, so much so that a virtual reality helicopter simulator has just been certified by European authorities. AOPA Live first showed you this device from Heli Expo in 2020. AOPA senior content producer Ian Twombly takes a closer look at this revolution in the training world.
VRM Switzerland thinks it has cracked the code.
Let's say a new technology in simulation area. Of course, it's not so new anymore. Virtual reality is, in the meanwhile, known everywhere. However, back in 2030, we started very intensive to do a lot of research to bring virtual reality together with the human body and so on.
Many training and simulation companies have promoted the benefits of virtual reality training, but until recently, most of the applications had too many drawbacks to be considered effective. Working with the European Aviation Authorities, VRM Switzerland said recently it has become the first company in the world to receive certification for a virtual reality simulation device that can be used in lieu of time in the aircraft to meet training minimums.
We are completely replacing the visual system away from those dome projections with a real 3D perception, full immersion by using virtual reality. That's one part. And the second part is, given with virtual reality, we don't see ourselves. We still want to achieve the level of what is called a full-scale replica cockpit. And we do that with our own system, which is called post-tracking, which is basically replicating the human body motions as an avatar. So we do have the full haptic in a full-scale replica. So you feel the switches, the buttons, the knobs, and all the things you need. And it's completely synchronized with what you see.
The student isn't required to wear sensors or make specific gestures in order to change items on the panel or operate the controls. Instructors sit outside the motion platform in a three-screen setup that shows the aircraft environment and, critically, where the pilot is looking. Those who tried it at Heli Expo in 2020 were impressed.
All the inputs and the controls, you can feel everything with the little shutter of the rotor system and everything. It's pretty slick.
The passion from the team, from VRM Switzerland, is we want to bring the best experience to the pilot.
Ian Twombly, AOPA Live.
Pricing on the simulator varies. The company says in all cases, training time in the VRM will be less than in the aircraft. They set that as a requirement early on, knowing that any safety-enhancing device must be a good value.
Well, a bittersweet week for us here at AOPA. You may remember our beloved colleague, Mike Collins, died of COVID-19 in February. We were unable to gather to support his loved ones and pay our respects due to the ongoing pandemic. Well, this week, many gathered outside AOPA headquarters to remember our friend by dedicating a tree planted in his honor. This oak tree stands in AOPA's legacy court, and it will be maintained in honor of Mike, who spent decades as our technical editor. The ceremony was attended by his youngest two children and his wife, Jeanette, who also works at AOPA.
While this occasion brings us together in our sadness, I am thankful and comforted to be with you, my friends. I know you are grieving too. I think about that often. That we can gather here in this place where Mike shared his many personal and professional gifts for almost half his life, to be together for this time of remembrance and tribute is very, very special.
There was a missing man formation flown over the ceremony in honor of Mike. We'll show you more of that at the end of the show. And you can watch the whole ceremony, which was live streamed on our YouTube channel. Well, Tom, it was a beautiful ceremony. I watched it live online.
It really was a spectacular day to remember Mike. Not only the weather fantastic, but it was great to see our colleagues out, many of whom we haven't seen in months and months. And Jeanette was incredible. She's a rock, and she inspires all of us. So anyhow, again, missing you, Mike.
That's right. Well, coming up, a first flight of a plans built airplane.
And a flight in the Immaculate 150. We'll be right back.
The future of USB charging power has arrived. Introducing new ultra-fast charging TA360 USB chargers. Unlock the power of USB power delivery PD technology. Max power. Multiple configurations. In-seat, cabin, cockpit, and galley USB power. Easy to install. Backed by the best. True Blue Power, the USB experts.
Welcome back. Want another reason to fly GA? Well, the airlines might start weighing you before you board. It's part of an effort to come up with a more accurate average passenger weight. Americans as a whole are getting fatter, and the FAA wants airlines, especially those that operate smaller cabin aircraft, to be able to more accurately calculate weight and balance. The data collected would be averaged to come up with an updated estimate for the modern passenger. And best think twice before mouthing off to that airline person trying to get your weight. The FAA is serious about going after passengers who interfere with flight crews. The feds this week proposed fines of up to $52,000 for passengers who refused to comply with crew member instructions and in one case assaulted a flight attendant. The FAA says it is strictly enforcing a zero tolerance policy.
We pilots are good at breaking things. We rely on the skilled labor of aviation maintenance technicians to keep our airplanes in tip-top shape. Whether it's a minor squawk or a major overhaul, A&Ps and others do a remarkable job, and it's only fitting May 24th is Aviation Maintenance Technician Day. So hats off to all of you from all of us. Speaking of hats and things like that, one of our own has even more reason to celebrate. Carlo Sillars is AOPA's lead aircraft maintenance specialist. He also works the phones as an expert in the Pilot Information Center, PIC. You may have talked to him when you called in. This week, he's got a lot of smiles. His hat's biplane he's been plans building for the last 4 years flew for the first time. AOPA's Dave Hirschman doing the honors as test pilot for the initial flight. Well, this is not Carlo's first build by far. He previously scratch-built a Bushby Mustang II that won numerous awards. Carlo's craftsmanship is second to none, and we wish him the very best with his new beauty.
That's right. Congratulations, Carlo. Well, we introduced you last week to a man who restored a Cessna 150 to factory new condition. This week, we go for a flight in his fully restored trainer. AOPA Vice President of Publications Colin Stagnito takes us along.
Meet Dennis Osmond. Like many of us, he learned to fly in a Cessna 150. He loves the fun and simple airplane and decided to restore a 1968 model to showroom new condition.
Good then, mixture of bridge. Ready for a start?
Yep.
Clear prop! Ready.
When you purchased a Cessna 150 new from the dealer in 1968, this is what it would have looked like. How does it fly? We enjoy an early morning flight at Quincy Regional Airport to find out.
Here we go.
Hey,
climbing like crazy.
Oh yeah.
Wow. That's sweet. Like you said, it's a 150, it's you know what? For fun flying, if you just want to get up in the air and enjoy a beautiful morning like this, can't beat it.
It's hard to beat. You're exactly right. It's not an overly taxing airplane. You're not worried about landing gear, you know, coming up and down. And
it's just
an airplane to go fly. And it's about flying. It's not about going somewhere. It's about flying.
Quincy traffic, Cessna 232, left downwind 22, Quincy.
So how much does performance change on a high density altitude day on an aircraft like this?
You definitely know a difference.
Yep.
When it's cool and, you know, high density, it wants to fly. When it's hot and you're heavy, you can definitely tell it. I go ahead back to about 1500 here, and I'll go ahead and put in 10 degrees flaps.
Here we are.
Yeah, so.
This is trimming pretty good, maybe a little bit more. Here we go.
Quincy traffic, Cessna 232, left base, 22, Quincy.
Put in a little more here.
Yeah, go ahead and put 20. And then I'll go to 30 on final.
Okay. Wow, I mean, this is, look at this day.
It's nice.
It's kind of the day the airplane just wants to fly itself.
Oh yeah.
Oh my goodness, everything's happening in slow motion.
That's right.
Quincy traffic, Cessna 232 final, 22 Quincy.
Perfect.
All right.
Yeah, when we were restoring this airplane, trying to be original with everything and all the little details. Just even like this piece of plastic,
always cracks.
It always cracks.
Yep.
And, you know, this is an original Cessna part. Everything in here is Cessna. There's no reproduction parts anywhere on the airplane. Everything's new old stock or original to the airplane.
Wow.
Osmond thought it would be nice to restore an airplane that was very special to many of us in aviation, and he nailed it. Colin Stagnito, AOPA Live.
Well, if you missed the story of this stunning restoration, you can see the video right now on aopalive.org. And that's our program for the week. Thank you for joining us. We'd love to hear from you in the comments or by email.
Yes, we would. And we're going to leave you this week with a look at our solemn tribute to our dear friend, Mike Collins. Here's a look at the missing man formation flown in his honor.
I'm a full-time filmmaker, and I integrate a lot of flying in with that and primarily produce film and videos around aviation. So I've got about 1,700 hours, about maybe 300 or 400 of that is dual given. My ratings are a commercial airplane, single engine land, and then I'm a CFII and just recently got my tailwheel. So I use SiriusXM weather hands down all the time on four flight. We were doing performance testing off the coast of Florida, and we needed unrestricted climbs with no clouds above us, and we needed unrestricted descents, no clouds below us. And we actually used the cloud layer that SiriusXM feeds to the iPad, and it was shockingly accurate. I really tend to gravitate toward using SiriusXM in the cockpit because of the resolution of data that it's providing me. I mean, when I'm looking at NEXRAD or weather on the horizon or satellite cloud layers, anything like that, the resolution of the image that it's giving me is so much higher and so much more frequent than ADS-B, especially when you're operating in an IFR environment.